Assalamualaikum Pak Mahmud.
Waalaikumsalam Pak Indra.
Bukan Pak Indra ini, Pak Nasir.
Oh, Pak Nasir. Oh, oke. Pak Chair.
Gimana Pak Mahmud? Udah masuk?
Apanya ini masuk itu, Pak Nasir?
Itu, Bu Ika.
Oh, Bu Ika. Bu Ika kayaknya belum masuk, Pak Nasir. Saya suruh masuk sekarang ya, Pak Nasir.
Sehat kan Pak Mahmud?
Iya, sehat.
Makasih ya, Pak.
Assalamualaikum Pak Mahmud, apa kabar?
Waalaikumsalam Bu Wade. Baik, Bu Wade apa kabar?
Baik, Alhamdulillah. Udah rindu mau ketemu Bu Ika. Tunggu-tunggu belum muncul.
Ini udah saya suruh masuk, Bu. Sama saya nggak rindu, Bu.
Oh, sama. Lebih rindu lagi.
Lebih rindu
Lebih
lagi,
rindu
Pak
lah.
Mahmud.
Kapan ini Pak PhD baru apa? Jadi speaker di English Friday Forum ini.
Itu
Pengen
habis
dengar?
ini.
Pengen dengar kita ya kan Pak Ketua?
Iya, habis inilah.
Di sini.
Masa
Habis
orang
ini
lupa.
puasa pula, Bang. Kayak mana itu?
Iya. Tausiah lah Pak Mangun.
Tausiah pula ya, iya.
Ah,
Tausiah ya,
iya.
Bang. Sebentar ya Bapak Ibu.
Ini ada saya lihat Pak Toms ini ya. How are you Pak Toms? Long time
Pak
no see ya.
Pak Tom sehat segar selalu.
Nanti ada juga Prof. Berlin Sibarani. How are you, Prof? Sehat kan, Prof? Oh, masih ini aja ya, masih profilnya aja yang muncul.
Enggak, saya sudah hadir di sini.
Oh, sudah ya,
tapi saya mendua dengan ngasih kuliah di sebelah.
Oh, Bapak suka mendua ya.
Oh, jangan mendua, Pak Prof.
Itulah Ibu Mas Ito ini menangkap yang lebih enak memang.
Ibu suka mendua, Bapak suka mendua, tapi kalau ibu-ibu nggak suka diduakan, Pak.
Oh gitu ya, saya tidak menduakan Bu, saya hanya mendua saja. Soalnya di sebelah ada kuliah anak S2, di
Okay.
sebelah kita dengar-dengar, tapi karena menarik suara Ibu Mas Ito, terpaksa
Oh,
kita
gitu ya.
tinggalkan yang sebelah ini.
Oh, gitu ya. Thank you, Prof. Ini ada
Baik.
juga saya lihat. Hai, Bu Beta dari Pak Mahmud. Bu Beta yang mana ini ya? Pak Mahmud.
Ya,
good morning, Ben.
Nyonya
Oh, good
Sibarani.
morning. Oh, ya. Aduh, I really miss you, Beta. How are you?
I'm
S
fine,
Beta
Ben.
ya. Sorry ya, Prof. S Beta. I miss you, S Beta.
Itu siapa?
Iyalah. Sehat-sehat ya kan, Beta?
Sehat, Mem.
Ya, syukurlah.
Belum masuk juga ya, Ibu Ika? Oke, Ibu Ika-nya sebentar lagi bergabung bersama kita, Bapak Ibu.
Halo, Pak Mahmud.
Iya, Pak
Oh,
Willem.
Mr. Handsome. You're there. Nice to see you
Ah,
there.
masih kalah handsome sama Pak Willem.
Keren kali ya.
Wah, Pak. Baik.
Okay. Enjoy being the moderator, ya. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'll try my best, Pak.
Right.
Okay, thank you, Pak.
It'll be fun, yeah. Okay, right.
Hello, good morning Ibu Ika. Pak Mahmud?
Ya.
Yeah. Ibu Ika is already in this room.
Hello, good morning. Yes. Halo Pak Indra. I think I need to fix my camera. Something wrong with my video camera. Hold on.
Good morning Ibu Ika.
Good morning Pak Mahmud.
Mana kameranya Bu Ika?
Soon, Pak Mahmud.
Soon.
Ya, yeah, oke, okay, very soon. Ya,
lagi fixing dulu something
okay,
wrong.
Oke, okay. Yeah, iya, yeah. No worries, Bu Ika, no worries.
Hey, Pak Mahmud, Pak Mahmud nggak tanya kamera saya tadi, rupanya masih off ini ya.
Ah. Oh, masih off itu, Pak Wilam.
Nah, there you are, Pak Wilam.
Oke. Okay.
Gimana itu, Pak?
Pak Indra.
Hello,
yeah,
okay, Pak Wilam.
Okay, everybody. Yeah. Yeah. Nice to meet you here this morning.
Okay. Nice to meet you too, Pak.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Ibu Ika.
Selamat datang, Ibu Ika. It's ready for room.
Iya, yeah, selamat datang. Terima kasih, Pak.
Yes. Terima yeah. kasih kami. Hai. Kena yeah. hadir di sini untuk mengisi acara Friday Forum ini. Pada Jumat ini, gimana Pak Pak Indra? Udah kita bisa kita buka aja ya, udah Bika udah di sini.
Pak Dekan belum terlihat, sebentar sedang kita apa komunikasikan. Oke, sebentar Pak Nasirnya, ini Pak Dekan sedang kita komunikasikan dan segera bergabung dengan kita dan setelah itu langsung kita buka acara.
Yeah. Lebih seru kalau langsung ke Medan ini ya.
Silakan Bu Ika, silakan.
Assalamualaikum Bu Ika, how are you?
Halo.
Ini dari Bu Ika, ini Bu Masito.
Bu, apa kabarnya? Dulu kita jumpa-jumpa ya Bu.
Iya, aduh Bu Ika.
Itu disuruh pakai handset ya. Nah, ini tuh. Ya udah tuh, nggak usah pakai handset.
Jumpa di mana Bu Masito sama Bu Ika?
Hah? Siapa nih yang nanya nih?
Saya.
Pak Mahmud, waduh. Ada lah ya Bu Ika ya.
Coba dulu diceritakan ya, Bu Ika.
Soalnya mission possible. Gak boleh bilang-bilang.
Enggak, tapi kebetulan itu kan apa yang bisa jadi KS100 loh Bu Ika. Jadi kita bekerja sama dengan UI ya kan, dipakai UI untuk sebuah project. Itu jadi alhamdulillah jadi bisa untuk apa kegiatan kita di universitas yang masuk KS100. Alhamdulillah ya Bu Ika ya.
Iya, alhamdulillah.
Semoga ke depan kita bisa bersama lagi proyek yang sama ya Bu ya di apa Dikti ya.
Iya, Bu. Amin, amin. Udah pada vaksin belum?
Oh, iya ini sedang.
Unimed belum ada.
Iya.
Oh. Bu Ika sudah divaksin?
Aku tidak lolos screening.
Wow.
Jadi Bu Ika udah di Indonesia apa masih di sana?
Udah di Indonesia, Bu.
Udah di Indonesia ya. Ya syukurlah.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Iya.
Tidak lulus screening maksudnya gimana, Ibu?
Jadi kan kalau sebelum masuk ke bilik suntiknya kita ada screening dulu kan, dicek kolesterol, darah dan tensi. Kalau saya karena ada penyakit autoimun, jadi harus ada surat gitu. Clearance dulu dari dokter autoimunnya.
Dokternya. Ya.
Kayaknya nggak tahu harus bawa surat keterangan aman divaksin jadi ya.
Vaksinnya di UPI ya Bu Ika?
Apa?
Vaksinnya di UPI
iya,
gitu.
Iya.
Oh, yang menyelenggarakan universitas ya?
Iya, betul.
Unimed sepertinya menunggu geleran, Bu.
Iya, bersabarlah.
Iya, bersabarlah.
Iya, dan pastikan tensi darah baik, jangan
tinggi gitu ya?
Gula darah, ya.
Jadi banyak. Kalau yang tinggi nggak boleh ya, Bu Ika?
Nggak
ya?
Boleh, ya harus terkontrol dulu.
Oh, gitu ya.
Makanya Bu Dekan, Bu Wade, jangan tensian.
Iya agak supaya udah manula ini agak getting higher gitu Pak Mahmud.
Iya.
It used to be low.
It used to be low ya Bu.
Seiring usia menua di atas 50 tahun rupanya it's getting higher gitu loh.
Jadi Pak Mahmud ini.
Iya Ibu Ana. Ibu Ana akhirnya bersuara.
Iya Bu Ana.
Bu Ana Wilujeng Sumping.
Iya.
Orang Sunda ada Bu Ana sekarang.
Akhirnya ketemu ya Bu Ika.
Iya.
Akhirnya.
Wah indah sekali rumah Bu Ana.
Makasih Pak Mahmud.
Sekarang sekarang saya yang nanya ini Pak Mahmud dari di mana ketemunya Bu Ana sama Bu Ika?
Sama oh, ya. Oh, for your information ya Bu Masito yang bahagia Pak Mahmud. Aku yang ngajak ini loh Bu Ika ini loh. Nggak jelas ini Pak Mahmud yang berkawan sama Bu Ika ini loh.
Yeah. Tapi nanti kalau yang tanggung jawab bawa Bu Ika ke Kaldera dan Otoba itu Pak Mahmud. Bu Ika kan udah pengen kali ke Medan.
Pasti, itu udah saya udah janji dari kemarin-kemarin sama Ibu Ika. Karpet merah menanti di Kuala Namu.
Udah lama gak dengar ekspresi Bapak Mahmud seperti itu. Oh iya. Nah, kita jadi ini, apa namanya penyambut tamunya ya Bu Ana nanti ya.
Oke. Bapak Ibu, Pak Dekan sepertinya sudah ada di room ini.
Oh, iya.
Halo silakan. Pak Dekan, kita address dulu Pak Dekan. Halo Pak Dekan, ini video dan audionya sepertinya sudah menyala.
Ya Bunda.
Oh ya Pak, ya terima
Pak,
kasih
Pak. Kita apa ini? Pakai tiga apa ini?
Tiga device Pak langsung.
Komputernya tiga laptop.
Tiga gawai langsung.
Dunia zaman sekarang itu yang saya sebut dan itu kan.
Iya iya ya Pak Rekan. Ya beginilah kita. Oke. Okay. Nah baik kita langsung buka Pak Rekan.
Ya. Agan.
Okay. Ya ya baik Pak Rekan. Ya silakan Pak Nasir. Terima kasih Pak
Rekan. Awal juga. Selamat datang semuanya di Friday Forum Jumat ini 9 April 2021. Pertama-tama marilah kita bersyukur kehadirat Tuhan Yang Maha Esa, Allah Subhanahu wa taala, karena atas izinnya kita bisa melakukan kegiatan ilmiah ini ataupun kegiatan Friday Forum ini. Yang saya hormati Bapak Dekan FPS Unimed, Bapak Dr. Abdul Rahman Syahputra MPU, Bapak Dekan 1, Bapak Dr. Wahyu Triatmojo MPU, Ibu Dekan 2, Ibu Dr. Masito Warni Siregar MED, Ibu Dekan 3, Ibu Dr. Marice MPU, Ibu Ketua Jurusan, Ibu Anggreni Tesisya SPD MPU, Bapak Sekretaris Jurusan, Bapak Ida Hartoyo MPU, Ibu Ketua Prodi D, Ibu Nora SS SPD MPU, Ibu Ketua Prodi Nondik, Ibu Juli Ramadhani SSMU, dan Ibu Ketua Prodi, Ibu Kalab atau Kepala Laboratorium Ibu Farida Hanin SPDMU. Yang kami muliakan speaker kita Ibu Ika Lestari Damayanti MA PhD serta moderator yang pada hari ini Bapak Mahmud Layan MA PhD. Terima kasih atas kesediaannya untuk mengisi Friday Forum di Jumat Berkah ini. Perlu kami sampaikan bahwa kami dari Friday Forum jurusan Bahasa Inggris telah melakukan 9 kali kalau tidak salah acara seminar ini dan akan terus berkomitmen untuk terus menjadikan kegiatan ilmiah ini setiap bulannya. Terima kasih yang sebesar-besarnya atas dukungan dari semua bantuan dari pihak fakultas, jurusan, prodi, laboratorium. Insyaallah kegiatan ini akan terus kita lanjutkan bersama-sama dan bisa berjalan lancar. Terima kasih juga kepada seluruh tim Friday Forum-nya yang telah membantu dan bekerja keras di belakang ini. Untuk itu, tidak berpanjang lebar, kami mohon kesediaan Bapak Dekan FPS untuk membuka acara ini secara resmi pada Bapak kami. Silakan.
Terima kasih, Bu Nasir. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Berarti suara saya didengar. Puji syukur kehadirat Allah Tuhan Yang Maha Kuasa pada hari ini Fakultas Bahasa dan Seni khususnya jurusan Bahasa Inggris masih dapat melakukan aktivitas rutin yaitu Friday Forum. Yang terhormat Wakil Dekan 1 Fakultas Bahasa dan Seni Bapak Dr. Wahyu Triatmojo M.Hum, Wakil Dekan 2 Ibu Dr. Masito Warni M.Pd, Wakil Dekan 3 Ibu Dr. Marici M.Hum, yang terhormat Ketua Jurusan Bahasa Inggris Ibu Anggraini M.Hum, Sekretaris Jurusan Bapak Indra Hartoyo M.Hum, khusus yang kami muliakan narasumber yang sengaja kami undang, Ibu Ika Lestari Damayanti MAPHD. Selamat datang Ibu, walaupun dalam virtual ya. Yang terhormat Pak Mahmud Layan Uta Suhud M.Hum PHD dari Universitas Negeri Medan, terkhusus kepada Bapak Dr. Muhammad Nasir M.Hum ya selaku Ketua Forum Friday Forum ya, yang sampai saat ini terus aktif menggalakkan kegiatan ini yang terus menyebarkan ilmu pengetahuan untuk kita semua. Bapak Ibu fungsionaris Unimed, FBS Unimed, pada pertemuan ini sudah yang keempat ya Pak Nasir ya, di tahun 2021 ya.
Iya Pak.
Ya, nah jadi memang kita rutin setiap bulannya ya, mengadakan seminar yang pada awalnya seminar Jumatan ini adalah untuk jurusan Bahasa Inggris. Nah, tetapi berkembang untuk FBS. Nah, dengan memanfaatkan forum virtual ini, akhirnya kegiatan ini menjadi forum seminar yang melibatkan peminat dan peserta dari berbagai wilayah di Indonesia. Semoga kegiatan ini terus berkembang ya, menemukan hal-hal baru, teman-teman baru, konsep-konsep baru dalam kajian kebahasaan ya, baik linguistik maupun kependidikan kebahasaannya. Nah, mudah-mudahan suatu saat kita bisa juga mungkin pernah juga ya Pak Nasir ya, kita mendatangkan narasumber dari luar negeri ya.
Iya Pak.
Ya, mudah-mudahan nanti lalu. Kita ya. Nah, jadi memang kegiatan ini sudah menjalar, merambah ya. Tidak hanya di wilayah Indonesia, tapi juga kita sudah melakukan kerjasama dengan negara tetangga kita maupun nantinya akan menjadi forum yang gaungnya kita harapkan bergema ke dunia internasional. Terima kasih kepada Pak Dr. Nasir dan seluruh fungsionaris Bahasa Inggris dan yang terlibat dalam forum ini. Mudah-mudahan setiap kegiatan dan langkah kita membawa berkah bagi FBS dan bagi kita secara umum. Terima kasih. Saya akhiri. Bila topik wadaya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi. Selamat berwebinar. mohon maaf, ini saya ada 4 kegiatan yang harus saya penuhi. Nah, inilah kekurangannya kalau webinar. Baik, selamat webinar. Silakan, Pak Nasir.
Terima kasih, Pak Dekan, atas berkenannya membuka acara ini. Oh, saya lupa, Ibu Dr. Ana Tambunan. Terima kasih atas jemputannya. Maaf tadi, Bu. Selamat datang seluruh peserta. Untuk itu, saya langsung terus ke moderator, ke Bapak Mahmud Huta Suhud, PhD, untuk langsung ke pembawa acara ini. Pada Bapak, silakan.
Thank you, Pak Nasir. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning. It's a very good morning, isn't it? Before we begin the Friday forum today, I would first of all like to thank and welcome the Dean of Faculty of Languages and Arts, Bapak Dr. Abdurrahman Adi Saputra, M.Hum, Bapak dan Ibu Vice Deans, Head and Secretary of English Department, Chair of Friday Forum, and all of the participants here, professors, lecturers, teachers, and educators who have made the time to join this forum to share and to learn. In this Friday Forum, we are given a wonderful opportunity to learn from and to share our story with our speaker, Ibu Ika Lestari Damayanti, MA, PhD. Ibu Ika completed her PhD study and graduated from the University of Wollongong, Australia. I personally have known Ibu Ika since the first day I stepped my feet on the university ground, and since then she has been very, very helpful and kind, making it easier for me to adapt to uni life quickly. Besides being very helpful, I can also sense her passion for public speaking. One of her many achievements that I personally witnessed was her winning the People's Choice at the 2016 Asia Pacific 3-Minute Thesis, a competition where all contestants must present their thesis in 3 minutes only, using one presentation slide only, in front of audience from all over the world and a panel of scary judges. And Ibu Ika continued and still does to explore rigorously the use of speaking skills to improve young learners' experience in learning English in Indonesia through oral storytelling, which can now be read in her PhD thesis entitled Cerita, a pedagogical model for teaching story genres to lower secondary school students in Indonesia. And that is my cerita about Ibu Ika. And now it's a privilege of mine to present our speaker today, Ibu Ika Lestari Damayanti, MA PhD, Teh Ika. The floor is all yours now. Ibu Ika.
Terlempar kayaknya, Mut.
Excuse me? Ya, Bu Ana?
Seems Wait. That dia terlempar kayaknya.
Oh, yes. Trouble connection. Please be
yeah,
patient.
Try to call her.
Yes, okay.
No, she's back.
Okay.
So she's back in the room.
Yes, I'm back.
Yes, you're back. So I just finished introducing yourself to the audience here, Ibu Ika. So the floor is all yours now, Teh Ika.
Aduh, thank you, Kang Mahmud.
Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning everyone. It's an honor for me to be here with you all. Thank you Bu Anna for inviting me to come to Medan and share my experience related to public speaking. So I hope that the internet connection will be very friendly throughout the session. I hope I will be constantly here without getting kicked out by internet connection. Now please let me share my slides with you all. Udah bisa ya? Okay. Hang on. Iya. Yes, can you all see my screen now, my slide? Is it still open? Yeah. Well, while waiting for the slide to appear, okay, there you go. Can you all see it now? Yeah. So, actually, I'm not a very confident speaker but I know that I have to cope with it because as a teacher, I need to be speaking in front of public and I have to make sure that my audience are convinced with the things that I'm going to deliver. So getting nervous and being not very confident just at the start of the presentation is actually something quite normal. And probably most of you did not have that kind of trouble at all. So my presentation today is talking about how to cope with that kind of anxiety. So there are some of the tricks that I use to make my performance run smooth. Yeah? So this is the title of my presentation today, like head up, speak up, make yourself heard through public speaking, because many of us have lots of ideas, but sometimes because we are not too confident to speak in public, the ideas just cannot be heard by people. So let's get started now. As I mentioned earlier, I'm a teacher and I believe Pak Mahmud already mentioned that in the introduction. So I've been an English teacher for nearly, you know, I think more than 90 years now, 19 years. And I have been a presenter in a seminars, in a workshop and conferences held nationally and internationally. So this will help me to share and to get some ideas and principles that I usually apply when I did my presentation. So I'm going to share this with you all. And this is the agenda for today. We're going to talk about me and public speaking at first. And then the principles, and we are all going to experiment a little bit, just practicing how to do the public speaking using Flipgrid. If you know Flipgrid, could you please put thumb reaction? I'd like to know, do you know Flipgrid? Okay, Bu Anna, yes. How about others? Sambil ngecek, so far only Bu Anna yang showing thumb. Can you find thumb reaction? Okay, that's all right. So if you don't know Flipgrid, it's okay because I'm going to introduce that to you and it's quite easy to use as well. Oh, Pak Mahmud also knows Flipgrid, good. Okay. So maybe this is a little bit narcissistic because it's all about me and public speaking. But what I would like to share with you is that based on this experience, I have achieved the things that I've never imagined before, because as I mentioned earlier, I'm not really a confident speaker. I always have tummy ache before I did my presentation. And in fact, today I also have that kind of feeling, but I managed to get some awards in doing public speaking. So what is going on actually? So it's not only about people who have talent or have confidence or extrovert, but any type of personality that you have, you can always be a good public speaker. So that's what I want to share with you all. And before that, could you please go to menti.com and use this code 9372791493727914. So first of all, you have to go to menti.com. If you use your mobile phone or your laptop, you can just go there. And there you will find two questions actually, but we will go through one by one. The first question is, I don't know, what is it? Can you see the question in, Bu Anna, have you arrived there?
Yeah, Ibu. Yeah, I got it.
Yes, can you please?
The question is, when I speak in front of people, I feel nothing, awesome, nervous.
Yes. So you only need to choose one of them. So we're going to see like the majority of us, what kind of personality that you have when you are asked to do public speaking. Yeah. Okay. Let me stop share for a while and I will go to Mentimeter. Okay, 9 people so far has answered this question. And I know that there are more than 90 people here. So I expect you to go to menti.com and we're going to see the results, yeah? If you have any trouble, I don't think it's hard to go to menti.com. It's quite easy. And I believe that you are all familiar with this website. Yeah. Pak Mahmud, have you answered this one?
Yes, Ibu Ika. Definitely.
Okay. Nothing and awesome, still no one chose that one. Soalnya kalau dibilang awesome, terlangsung, coba kasih contoh, takut gitu kayaknya.
How many participants?
I think if I look at the participants today.
How many participants do you need to answer?
I think because I would love everyone can join in. Yes.
Okay.
Because, I think more than 90 people attending this, right? Attending this forum. 16 is very small number. I expect to have more people to join in. And actually, this is not only about whether your voice is important or not, but we can see that as a group in this kind of survey, we need to see the number. And if you are a teacher and you've never used menti.com before, perhaps this can be a good experience for you. So you can use this with your students as well during the online learning. And this is actually one of the strategies when you do presentation that you want to interact with your audience. And doing a survey like this is one of the examples. If we are doing this presentation like in a traditional way, like face to face, I can see you all. I can just simply ask you to raise your hand. But since we are doing this online, so I need to use this. So thanks to menti.com. That can accommodate this kind of interaction. Good, it's 21 and I hope more people join in. Pada punya kuota tapi kan. Students ya. Aduh maaf ya, bercanda aja. Karena Pak Mahmud itu is my best friend gak sih Pak Mahmud kita?
Best lah Bu.
teman seperjuangan, menangis bersama, tertawa bersama. Jadi kadang-kadang suka tidak kontrol kalau ada.
Oke, calm down, Ibu.
Oke, 22. Oh, wow. So, I mean, 23 people. But you all said nervous. I hope that it's not because at the beginning of the presentation, I said something, I'm not a confident speaker. And it influenced like you all to choose this one. Because I know that some people, they are very, very happy talking in front of people because, yeah, the kind of person like, very confident and wants everybody like hearing his or her ideas. Okay, anyway, so maybe we can just assume. can we say that 26 representing the 99 people or more than 90 people here? So when speaking in front of people, you all feel nervous. Yeah. All right. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. Okay, so this is where I usually have trouble. I hope not. Yeah, now for the next question, I would like you to type 3 words describing, Yeah, can you go to the next question? It's still in the same.
Yeah, still not yet, Ibu Ika.
Okay, yeah, still ding, 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 ding. Yeah. Okay, describe a good public speaker in 3 words. Can you see that now? Can you go to that one?
Yes, I can see it.
Yeah. Okay, just write 3 words that describe a good public speaker in your opinion.
Done it.
Wow. So that's yours.
Yes.
All right. Guess we're going to make cloud, word cloud. Wow, look, yep, nice. Okay, yep, more people joining in. Yes, so we have all confidence still biggest, yeah, like more, most people chose that, being confident is very important, yes. And then the next one is being friendly, yes.
Usually can.
Mm-hmm. Smart, yeah. Friendly, smile, yes. Clear, yes. Clear articulation. But still what we can see from this is that being confident is still number one. You have to be confident to be a good public speaker, followed by being clear and smart, because I think smart represents the ideas that you share with your audience. Being friendly is important. Okay, smooth. What else? Fun. Yeah, I think by being fun is that make sure that your presentation is engaging, so everyone feel that they are part of the presentation and they know that the ideas being presented is useful and relevant to their needs. Yeah, good looking. Oh, kalau good looking mungkin hanya Pak Mahmud aja ya yang bisa masuk.
Ah, senang dia itu.
Pasti biasa kan dia memang. Yeah, probably with good looking means that if it is in the same room, probably that makes sure that you are not smelly. Maybe that is the most important thing. Yeah, and especially if your audience is, your audience is a group of children, because they can be very, very honest in commenting on you. So good looking, yeah, I agree with you. You have to be well presented, yeah? All right, so far we can see that the big words here are being confident, smart, clear, fun, friendly. And I think being smart is not, it's not always about your intelligence, maybe being smart, like getting really high score in certain aspects. But being smart here is when you know, when you can address your audience needs, yeah? Because it can be very, very contextual as well. All right, so thank you very much for your participation. Let's go back to my slide. And if from this survey, people tend to be nervous when they have to speak in front of public, but they also know that it's very important to be confident when you speak in front of public, yeah? All right. And with this kind of online presentation, you also need to be confident operating this crazy technology. And sometimes you also need to have a control when the internet connection is not really friendly. That's actually what I'm experiencing now. Anyway, let's move on. So what's the point of public speaking actually? Is it about getting the talk done? Like I know that I have around 2 hours here to present to you. So is it as long as I finish my presentation and then that's it? Or I need to make sure that the message can be understood, the message can be well received by my audience. So actually it's a little bit of both, yeah? Getting the talk done, important. And getting the message across, that's important too. And I think getting the message across is the most important one, but you also need to remember that when we are doing public speaking, we don't have the whole day. Usually you will be limited by time. It's not like when we talk in a coffee shop with friends, you can just spend hours and hours talking from one point to another, and then sometimes they are not really related, but that's the nature of coffee shop talk. But in public speaking, usually you will be limited by time as well as space and the audience. Yeah, so getting the talk done is important by being aware of the time that you have, and then getting the message across is also important. Make sure that you give clear articulation, just like some of you mentioned in the survey before. Clear articulation is important and being smart is important as well. So in doing public speaking, we need to aim for getting your ideas and thoughts heard by public. So it's very important. It doesn't matter whether in the audience you have your previous lecturers, your senior lecturers, your pejabat, and or people with you think more intelligent than you, but you are given this opportunity and people want to know your ideas. So in your presentation, your ideas are the most important thing, need to be heard by the public, by the audience at that time. So you need to convince the audience as well. You need to persuade others to agree with you. So you need to, like my argument here is that even though I'm not a confident speaker actually, but I can convince you with several tips and strategies, I can help you to be a more confident speaker, because those strategies obviously help me in doing my presentations, even though perhaps at the beginning it's a little bit shaky, but once I'm at it, I think I'm good at it. So that's what I want to share with you. And then you also need to remember that when you do public speaking, you also want to make a difference for the betterment of your community. Yeah. So a good public speaker is always concerned with their audience's interest and confident with their own capacity. Because sometimes it's not only about you. It's not only about your achievement but actually people want to know how you achieve those achievements, yeah? So you also need to think about your audience interests and their needs and do some survey or research, ask the committee like what the audience wants or needs related to your expertise. And here are my journey. Here are some presentation experiences that I have been through. At first, as a student, I did my presentation just part of my class assignments. So in this case, I need to convince, first of all, my lecturers. So I aim to get an A, for example, for my presentation. So the first audience that I have in my head is my lecturer, but of course I also have my friends. Unless the teacher asks peer assessment, so I would think about my friends as well. Tapi kalau bagian dari assignment, usually I think about the teachers or the lecturers' criteria. And then I presented in national and international seminars, and I would look at the time slot that I have, because some seminars, they gave you 20 minutes, 15 or 10. I have to make sure that my presentation will finish within the required time. I don't want to over or to exceed, or the time is running out while I still have some important points to say, because you cannot say to the committee. Yeah, like, hang on, because I still haven't finished my conclusion. I need 5 more minutes, let's say like that. But you cannot do that. If, for example, the conference is in your place and you are the head of of the prodi, probably you can say that to the committee. But if you are doing, but it would be very not professional, yeah, if you do such things. So in the international seminars, they are very strict in terms of time, because there will be other presenters to present. So you have to make sure that your presentation can be finished within the required time, yeah? And then I have this very, very important moment in my life when I did a panel session in IATEFL UK. So that was in 2006 back then. So I have my experience in doing presentation in seminars with 15 or 20 minutes, but in a panel session, I have to share the 20 minutes with 4 other speakers. So I have to speak in 5 minutes. So at that time, I thought that it would be very hard to talk about my research in 5 minutes. But then I have support from my colleagues. So we rehearsed. So we really need to rehearse and to make sure that I can finish my presentation in 5 minutes. At that time, I did not know a lot about how to make sure that I can cover the background, literature review, research method, findings just in 5 minutes. So at that time, I took a lot of time in preparing, rehearsing, until I finally can finish my presentation in 5 minutes. But then when I did my 3-minute thesis competition in Wollongong, so 3-minute thesis competition is a competition for PhD students. So they have to talk about their 100,000 word thesis or dissertation in 3 minutes. So I think it's even crazier than the panel session that I did back then in 2005, because I have to talk about so complicated research just in 3 minutes and using only 1 slide. So at that time, I learned a lot about how I can manage the time, like how many words. So I have to think about how many words I should say in 1 minute, let's say, because I have to make sure that I can cover everything in 3 minutes. And then I also got experience or got an opportunity to be invited in TED Talk in Wollongong. And at that time, I was asked to do my presentation in 15 minutes. So talking about the same thing that I presented in 3 minute thesis competition, but this time I have to talk about it in 15 minutes. So it's more like make it smaller and then make it bigger as well. It's like rubber. I have to think of some strategies how to make it, how to make my presentation done in 3 minutes, and then I have to stretch it into 15 minutes. So those are the things that I'm going to share with you as well today. Okay. not only doing traditional presentation where I can see all my audience in person, but with pandemic now, and I think it's going to be a common practice with the new normal, we all talk in webinars, just like what I'm doing now, and also perhaps you presented your thoughts through YouTube videos. So this was done in the beginning of the pandemic. I did my first webinar, and also I did this public speaking, we can say that, or in Wollongong. And this one when I was featured by ABC Australia. So those are three types of public speaking, but with different kind of modalities that I should use different kind of strategies by being aware of what kind of modalities are available for me to present my thoughts and ideas. So here are the principles. So after going through those experiences, I finally can withdraw some principles that we really need to consider when we want to do public speaking, and we want to make sure that our presentation is a compelling one that make our participants or audience interested in our talk. So what and how to make your voice heard? I think if you know systemic functional linguistics, so I really draw my principles on that theory. I believe that you are familiar with that, but perhaps do you know the three register? Mungkin ada yang mau berbagi sedikit? Yang belajar systemic functional linguistics? Kayaknya Pak Mahmud aja deh yang jawab.
Apa itu Ibu Ika?
Iya, yang register itu variable register itu ada apa aja ya?
Apa aja?
Aduh, di tes. Pak Indra?
Maybe you mean the field tenor and mode?
Yes, that one. Aduh, Pak Mahmud okay. Lambat. Makasih Pak Indra for being bercepat.
Belum sarapan, Bu.
Yeah, thank you, Pak Indra. Yes,
it has. You're welcome, Ibu.
With field tenor and mode, yes. So it's those three are very important, I think, in preparing our presentation. So in terms of, it keeps coming back. Yeah. Okay. So when we present something, it must be about a certain topic, but subject matter. So what we need to consider, like, for example, when I had this invitation, I will ask what kind of topic that I need to share or present. So I will think about the topic. And then presentation structure. So I need to know as well, like, the time. So presentation structure is closely related to the time that you have. Like for now, for example, it's around 2 hours. So I have to think about what I'm going to include in my beginning, and then what will be in the middle, and how I'm going to end my presentation. So when we consider the field or the topic, you focus on what kind of subject matter that you're going to present and presentation structure. So it has to do with the time. And then move on to the tenor or the audience. So we need to think about who will be in the audience. Like, are they going to be lecturers? If they're lecturers, from what major? Are they from English department, or are they from engineering? Things like that. And ask whether there are students. If it is a mix, so you have to also think about the various needs that lecturer and students might have. Think about the educational, cultural, and social background, area of interest, and probably age and gender can also make a difference in preparing your presentation. And then the mode, whether it is face-to-face or online. If it is face-to-face, like, are you going to stand in a podium, or are you going to stand on a stage or what? So you also need to consider that. So will there be any microphone, or you have to shout, projecting your voice throughout the rooms? Like, how many audience will be in your presentation? And then in terms of the tools, you need to think about the lightings if you are in a face-to-face, because sometimes, like when I did my 3-minute thesis competition, for example, I cannot really see my audience because the lights were so bright from every corner. So I can't really see my audience, including this time, for example, in the Zoom. When I did my presentation, of course, I can have my gallery view where I can see you all. Some of you turn off your camera, some of you turn on. Those who are turning on the camera, thank you, because I know that you, I know your reaction, because it will help me as well to tell me whether you are with me or not. But those who are not turning on the camera, I can understand as well, because sometimes if it is in the morning, ibu-ibu, you will be like doing juggling things with in the kitchen probably, or maybe with the internet connection. And also, it depends on the apps, whether you are using Zoom or Google Meet, because they also have different kind of features. So before you do your presentation, make sure that you know what kind of mode that that will be used when you do your presentation. So this is the timing that I mentioned, very, very important if you are going to present in a very timed presentation, just like what I did in 3-minute thesis competition. So as you see from the picture here, the time is displayed there. It can be very distracting, but through practice, you need to control everything, like your anxiety, but at the same time, you have to be aware of the time that you spent, that you don't want to exceed the 3 minutes because you will be disqualified. So these are the things that you might want to consider after you are told by the committee, for example, you have like 15 minutes to talk, and then it will be followed by question and answer session. Maybe you don't have to think much about question and answer session. Focus on the presentation. If you have 15 minutes, like how many slides do I have to prepare? I know that you have lots of brilliant ideas, but you cannot put everything in your slides. I know sometimes important people, when they are invited to a presentation, for example, even though only 15 minutes, because they are so smart, they have like 50 slides. I don't know whether 50 slides can be delivered in 15 minutes, but it depends again on the type of talk that you are delivering. Kalau misalnya sedang membicarakan tentang film studies and you have to show the slides, so many slides quickly, then it will be reasonable if you have 50 slides for 15 minutes. But if it is like common regular presentation talking about your research, and this can be used as your guidelines. Yeah, one slide can be delivered in 1 to 3 minutes, actually. And 1 minute usually consists of 100 to 150 words. I'm the person who tend to speak fast, but I know that I need to be aware it's not good, because when you speak too fast, it won't be very clear. And if you speak too slow, maybe it might bore your audience. And for my case, if I try to slow down my speed, sometimes I can lost in my track. So it's a bit hard. It means you need to practice to make sure that you're not going to speak too slow or too fast. And 100 and 150 words can be used as a guideline for you. But this can be useful if you are asked to present within very limited time. But if you have 2 hours, I think you can just use the guide from the number of slides that you can use, yeah? And when you talk about the audience, you might want to think about whether your audience is like people with certain expertise, as I mentioned earlier, or are they just common people without background knowledge with certain concepts? Like, for example, when I talk about my research in front of people who are familiar with functional linguistics, I will not go through every detail of the functional model of language. But if I talk about my research in front of people who are not familiar with systemic functional linguistics, it means I need to give time, I need to allocate time to unpack the theories in language that can be understood by my audience. So it will be a balance between commonsensical words and then technical terms. It's not always like being smart is not, being smart doesn't mean that you, when you present, you use lots of technical terms that people won't understand that. So I think in public speaking, that's wrong. If you are smart, if you can explain highly technical terms to people who don't know about the theories at all. So when you talk about, for example, I think being smart is that when you can talk about complex theory of systemic functional linguistics to two people from engineering, let's say, or from people who does who don't know anything about linguistics. And I know systemic functional linguistics have very complex theory and lots of jargons and technical terms. And it's very important for us if you want to convince people to use the theory for language learning and teaching, let's say, then you need to convince other people by unpacking these technical terms. So that's what I did when I won this competition, because my dissertation is based on systemic functional linguistic theory, and I have to present in front of people from various backgrounds. So some of them are from medical school, engineering, sciences, stuff like that. Yeah. So in this picture, this is where I presented in TED Talk in Wollongong. So actually, I still talk about my dissertation when previously here in the above picture, that's when I presented my presentation in 3 minutes, then I need to stretch it out into 15 minutes in TED Talk. So what I can do with that is I can give more examples actually in a longer presentation. So what do you have to prepare after, you know, the principles? As I mentioned earlier, outlining and timing. So how much time do you want to spend in the beginning, in the middle, and the ending? If you talk about your research, for example, it's very important to set up a background or context why your research is very important. So the beginning, you don't have to take very long, but you make sure that you can convince audience that there is a need, there is a problem, and your research can be a solution to the problems that you mentioned. And then in the middle, you can talk about how you did your research, including the results. And then you put the ending there with a powerful quote that people can remember, because at the end, probably people will not remember what you said in the middle, but they will remember what you said at the end of your presentation. So even though the ending seems that's why it's very important for you to talk within the time limit, because you can make your ending powerful. And now there are ways that you can do to engage the audience. Like you can use an inspiring quote at the beginning or a quick survey, just like what I did with you all using Mentimeter, or you can use story, rhetorical questions, and probably using verbal or physical responses, just maybe like a question that I asked earlier and Pa Indra responded to me. And probably you might want to have physical responses or with online platform, you can ask your audience to put emojis, just like what I asked you earlier, and like putting thumbs up reaction. And this is very important. The next step is practice, practice, practice. So practice your vocal range again after you know what kind of presentations that you're going to have, whether it is online or face-to-face. Are you going to have it in a small room, in a bigger room with microphone or not? This will influence the way you project your voice. And I think with online, you cannot really yell or project your voice too loud because the microphone is there in your gadget, yeah? And then gesture and body language. So it is a bit hard sometimes with online like this because you need to look at your slides and then trying to find certain certain buttons, but or with this kind of online, you will have tendency to look at your own face in the screen, but actually it is, I'm still practicing using it, is that you need to look at where your camera is. So when you do this, when you do your presentation online, make sure that you look at straight to your camera, just like when you look at your audience. But sometimes it's a bit hard, and for myself, I need to practice doing that because I can't help it. I can't help it because when I see my face on the screen, I want to see my face, whether my kerudung is in the right position or not, things like that. It's quite annoying. But if you want to be a good speaker in online presentation like this, try to look at the camera. And it requires practice. And then you can also record yourself. So before you do your presentation, especially the one like 3 minute thesis competition, only 3 minutes, and it is a competition, you have to be perfect. You record yourself and see whether you are happy with it or not. You can always ask your friend's opinion, and you have to be open-minded, and gaining criticism from your friends can be useful. And also look to the stars. This is what I did before I prepare my presentation, especially for the 3 minute thesis competition. For example, I look at lots of videos of the winner. So I learned from them how they did their presentation and how they make their presentation structure, what they did in the beginning, in the middle, and how they ended their presentation. Yeah. All right, so this is the outline. As I mentioned earlier, to prepare your presentation, you need to do the outlining and also timing. This is the beginning and then the middle, the ending. And I also put the time. So to talk about the beginning of my presentation up to the middle, I allow myself to speak in 1 minute because I want to make sure that everyone agrees with me that there is a problem in learning additional language. Yeah. And in the beginning, I use a big issue relatable to wider audience by using a character. So actually that character is one of the participants in my research. And I said that this person has trouble in learning English because of blah, 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 something like that. And that character is actually developed throughout my presentation. So even though that character has problem, but this character participated in my research and getting some treatments. And finally, this character can use English language better. So at the end, I show a happy character. So I still show the character that I introduced earlier in my presentation. So it's more like a story itself, because actually when you present something, you are telling stories. All right, so you might want to think about how you start your presentation, what kind of thing that you are going to highlight, whether you want to introduce a character or you're going to just straightforward asking questions, whether the audience have similar problems or not. Now, I'm going to show you examples of how I invited my audience to engage with my presentation by inviting them to respond verbally and physically. This is I took from TED Talk.
There were so many crocodiles who were hungry and wanted to eat her. She said, "Hey, crocodiles, I know that you are all hungry and want to eat me. But look at you. There are so many of you and only one me. But don't worry. I will make sure that each and every one of you will get equal share of my body. I will count. I will jump on you, but don't eat me yet. And I will say what you'll get. And you will say it with me. Are you ready, crocodile? Yes? I cannot hear you, crocodile. Are you ready? Good. Satu. Okay. Kepala. Dua. Tangan. Tiga. Kaki. And on, and on, and on.
Okay. Oh.
Ibu Ika?
Yes.
There are some questions here already for you from from the audience. Perhaps you can, while presenting, perhaps you can answer some of them.
Yeah. Okay. Can you please select questions for me?
The first one here is from the Friday Forum. The Friday Forum, one of the members, he or she said that she's not a pro yet, a professional yet, in public speaking. So what should we do if, you know, we suddenly experience panic attack or forget the line? You have the experience, I believe.
Yes, I have lots of experience, like bad experience as well. And as I told you, even at the beginning of this presentation, I have troubles. I didn't expect to have very bad connection today. But again, the show must go on. And always, because you know what makes us feel small is that because we are thinking about other people's opinion. We are so busy thinking about other people's judgment. And usually it's the negative judgment. Like I know, this is the negative thoughts that I have. Yeah, for example, before I did this presentation, I'm being honest with you. Like, oh, masa sih katanya udah PhD, tapi kok masih belepotan sih ngomongnya? That is the negative thought that I have, yeah. One of the thing. Oh, katanya. kira-kira katanya udah juara ini, juara itu, tapi kok masih punya technical problems, nggak bisa buru-buru di ini, kok nggak ada persiapan? So I have that kind of bad thoughts, but that's in my head. And maybe, I don't know, kalau mau bersuuzon, apakah mungkin itu ada di benak ibu bapak sekalian? Tapi saya tidak mau merayakan. I don't want to celebrate that kind of bad thoughts. So I will just press them down and think about good people that I know in there, in the audience. I know Pak Indra. Pak Indra greeted me so warmly today. And then I know Pak Mahmud is there. He's my friend, Ibu Ana, Ibu Masito. And I know, because I know lots of good people in my audience, and I know the rest of them will be like, they are good people as well. So I try to press down the negative judgment that I thought the audience might have by thinking more about good people that I have that will support my success in doing this presentation. So that is one of the thing when I got very nervous. But what happened if it is that you went blank in the middle of your presentation? I know it will be panic. But again, the first thing that you need to control is that you are among good people. That's very important. Because you are invited, you are given the floor, because they trust you. They trust your expertise, and they want to know your thoughts and ideas. So calm down, you are among good people. They're not going to eat you. They are not crocodiles. So once you are calmed down like that, you know you are among good people. Stop, make a pause. If you don't understand, if you cannot recall what you have to say, just think ahead, because especially if you are limited by time, think ahead, because I know that there is a blank spot, but you know that you need to move on to the next point. Just go to the next point and move on. But if you have more time, if you like, you can go back a little bit, step back to the last word that you remember, and then move on. So those are the things that I usually do if I went blank like that. But the most important thing that I have to plant in my head is that I'm among good people. That's very important. Yeah.
Okay. That's really clear. I hope that answers the question from the Friday Forum and also from Monica, because Monica has a pretty similar question to the one before. There is another question here, Bu Ika,
okay.
If you still have the time. It's,
yeah, sure.
It's a final examination question type. if you see what I mean. It's from Mr. Tom. Pak Tom here asks, I think if I can just summarize the question, as a public speaker, do we have to always mingle with the floors before we begin the lecture or the presentation? Is it a must?
Do you mean mingling, like
when you
have face-to-face?
Well, get together with the floors, with the people.
It's your choice, actually. If you are that kind of person, then just go for it. But some people, they don't really like doing mingling, especially with strangers. And then just don't do it because it will make you even nervous. So I think it depends on your personality. If you think that it's okay before my presentation, I can just go mingling. And then when it's time, when it comes to your time, you can just go to the stage and speak. But some people, they need time to calm down. So they don't even want to talk to people, just focusing, and it's also fine. But you can mingle definitely after your presentation because you have, you release the burden. Again, it's just up to you. But for me,
does it have any influence? Does it have any influence to the way you present your, let's say your lecture or your topic?
No, because it doesn't matter if you are being very, very friendly when you are mingling with people, but once you are on stage and you did not consider the principles that I mentioned earlier, it won't still make you a good public speaker. Yeah, just because you are friendly when you talk outside the stage, for example. But yeah, you also, because when you are presenting your points, you need to consider those things that I mentioned earlier. So even, for example, during the competition, if I know all the judges and I'm being friendly with them, it won't affect their judgment because they will still see me as a person who is presenting something on the stage.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Ibu Ika. I believe that answers your question, Pak Tom. I hope it's clear enough. I think we should move on to the next slide, perhaps.
Yeah. Okay.
Hello, Mahmud. Hello. Can I say a word?
Yeah, sure. Definitely. Pak Willem.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
Yeah, Pak Willem.
I'm now outside, actually. That's why, sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Yes, I'm interested in Ibu Ika's explanation regarding the question raised by the one before Pak Tom, yeah?
Yeah.
That is about forgetting the lines, right? it was interesting how to anticipate problems that may arise during the public speaking, right?
Yes.
I think that one more thing related to that is interesting to know and important to know is how to overcome the arising problem. Because I noticed that the explanation given by Bu Ika was about anticipating problems. Yeah. For example, don't focus on the negative judgments, just forget them all. But prioritize the good things about those audience like that. But how? That is, of course, anticipating, right? Yeah, just in case. So that is before the show, right? Before the show begins. But how, when it has happened, someone has forgotten the line, what should be done? Maybe that is interesting to know.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask. Thank you.
Right. Actually, it happened to me when I did TED Talk, Pak. So it happened to me.
Did you forget the line? Did you forget any line?
Yes.
Yeah, so what did you do to overcome that problem?
And can you imagine the burden? Because at that time, that was my first time, and I don't know whether I will have that kind of opportunity being offered presenting in TED Talk in a prestigious presentation event. And silly me, I forgot my line. And it was in the middle of the presentation like that. And, you know, so again, the same thing. I did the same thing because I know that I'm among good people. So I just stop. I pause. Jadi ketimbang sebetulnya pausing is better. You pause and then you stop. Take a deep breath. That's very important. Remember to breathe. Karena kalau udah kayak gitu suka lupa bernafas, beneran lupa. Dan ketika lupa bernafas itu makin panik sebenarnya. Jadi you stop, just stop, and then take a deep breath, smile to the audience, because actually the audience also know that sometimes they know, sometimes they don't know. It depends on how long you pause actually. So I had experience having very long pause and very short pause. In 3-minute thesis competition, I also went blank one time, but that's very short time, so I can move on. The judges, they were not aware. Even Mahmud was there, and Mahmud said he was not aware that actually there was time I went blank. But in TED Talk, it's quite, I think quite long. Tapi nggak nyampe 1 menit. Longnya juga within seconds juga ya. Karena juga saya udah practice, because I practice a lot. So if you have practice, I think somewhere in your head, you already have a map, Pak. So as I mentioned earlier in the principles that you need to make an outline and timing. The outline is the visual that you can have while you are presenting. Because in my presentation, for example, I make like a mountain like that. So when I did my beginning, I know that I was just about to climb up. So when I go down, I know in which part of going down that I... In 3-minute thesis, for example, I went blank somewhere when I was about to go down. Yeah, so I can picture it in my head. So I know what points I need to say after this. Yeah, so it's very important for you to have an outline. And some people, this is from the experience of my other colleagues, they think about a layout of a house. So when they do a presentation, when they talk about a background, she will think about her balcony, for example. And then when talking about the research method, she will think about her kitchen. So that kind of visualization can help you as well, actually, to make you aware in which part of presentation are you in. So in case you went blank, you will notice, oh, I'm in the kitchen. So in the kitchen, I will talk about how I collected the data and how I analyzed the data. So I just need to move on. I think things like that, Pak Willem. Maybe you all can make your own visualization. Yeah. Maybe Mahmud will think about his shoes because he really loves shoes. So maybe the... just use anything that can help you, Bapak.
Thank you. Thank you, Ibu. That's a really, really useful tip. Yes. Yeah.
All right. Yeah, that's right. Now, Ibu Bapak, can before we discuss other questions as well, I know that there are still some questions. Yeah, can we just focus first on my presentation here? Inviting verbal or physical responses to the audience. Do you have any comment on that, on the strategies, or perhaps you want to comment on the effect or stuff like that? Go ahead. Tadi apa ya? Yes, Ibu Bapak.
Ah, Ibu Ika, Pak Mahmud, sorry, it's so noisy here, yeah. So I thank Ibu Ika a lot for that explanation. That's what I wanted to hear, yeah. Thanks a lot, Ibu Ika.
Yes, Willem.
All right.
Thank you for the question as well. All
right. Okay, right.
Yeah, take care. Yes, Ibu Bapak, any comments on the strategy that I just showed you when I invited physical and verbal responses from my audience? Yes? Halo. Kalau kalau lagi kuliah sih saya nyebut nama boleh nggak? Memilih boleh nggak Pak Mahmud?
Feel free. Nggak, tuh, Bu Ika. You can.
Yes, yes, Bu Ana, mangga ya. Bu Ana, silakan.
There is... Oh, oke, okay, Ibu Ana. Ya. Yeah.
Maksudnya, mangga sebut nama aja.
Oh, mangga. Manggaku ini atau mangga romani? Okay, there is another question.
Sorry, moderator, can I say something related to the video that has been exposed by the speaker just now?
Yes, Ibu Neni. Oh,
iya, yeah, Ibu Neni. Go ahead. Yeah. Yeah, fire away.
I think those videos shows us that is very appropriate strategy used by the speakers dealing with the verbal and physical responses. Because if we talk about verbal responses delivered by the speaker at that video, it is very clear verbal responses by giving clear words and then also appropriate statements to have and encourage others or the listeners' responses. And if we just talk about the strategies on giving the physical responses to involve other attractions dealing with their ability in answering questions and understanding the messages from the speaker, it is very ideal strategy according to me. Thank you very much, Miss Ika. Yeah. I think you have displayed that video to have some inspirations and also some idea for us as the teacher here to use that strategy appropriately in our teaching and learning processes in the classroom for our students. Those strategy on using physical and verbal responses are very appropriately done, I think. And also, I'm just like to have some comments also related to that video. Those gesture, yeah, gesture used by the speakers is good, and also the verbal, yeah, the word per word is very clear enough, and also the pronunciations, also their accuracy. But the problem is when we are being as a speaker in public speaking area, especially maybe take it for example as speech competitions, can we do accuracy very fast, Miss Ika, or should we do it in balance? How is the ideal? How is the ideal accuracy should we use to manage speech well in convincing the idea to be understood by the listeners well? Should it in a very fast accuracy or in the middle accuracy? The point is, how can we manage those messages can be delivered well to the audience? The second one, what about our pronunciations? We are coming from Eastern, see? We are not Western. So how can we manage our pronunciations to be ideal portion at that time in an English speech competition? Thank you very much. That's my response, Pak Moderator. And Miss Ika, that was very interesting. Thing and inspirative video and explanations also according to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Bu Neni.
Bu Neni, see, as I told you, we are among good people because we are, and Bu Neni is one of them. Thank you, Bu Neni, for your kind words and positive comments. So let me address the first one related to my video. Yes, because here is, I'm trying to give examples of how easy it is to teach additional language or a foreign language using stories. So in this video, in this presentation, I try to convince my audience that learning, they can learn Bahasa Indonesia easily through stories. So I introduced them to body parts. And probably the gesture when I pointed using my index finger, it can be considered rude to some culture probably, but it's because I frame it in my story, so I think it's okay. And when I, at that time, actually I was really, really nervous because I did not know whether my audience will respond as I expected or not. Because sometimes, like we, I don't know, in my experience when doing online Zoom with my students, when I ask questions, nobody answered. Some of them turn off their camera, I don't know what they did, something like that. So yeah, and at that time, even though I have that kind of negative thoughts, And as you see from the beginning that I did not receive any sufficient response that I expected. Like, I cannot hear you, crocodile, because I think the audience themselves was not so sure how to respond to my question. So I repeated myself, and then I think that make them aware, oh, okay, this speaker want me to respond something. So that's what I did. I think that is also one of the strategies when the thing did not happen as you expected. So you can repeat yourself, and you, if still that doesn't happen, you can always ask the audience directly, could you please respond to my questions? Maybe something like that. Just like what I did earlier. I'm forcing Ibu Ana to to comment on me, for example. But there are lots of things going on, actually. I mean, it's not always because your presentation is not good. Maybe some, because in the presentation like this, when you invited responses from audience, it also requires them, confidence, because not so many people, even in the audience themselves, they are confident enough to respond because they are afraid of being judged as well. Jangan-jangan ini bukan sih yang dimaksud sama speakernya, aku harus ngerespon ini bukan sih, apa sih yang disuruh gitu ya. And actually it's just like what is happening in our classroom when we ask question to our students, they don't answer. It's maybe because our question is not really clear and they are afraid that what they give to us is not correct and they will be bullied by their lecturer or maybe by their friends. Yeah, so your question is about speech competition. What kind of accuracy, what kind of pronunciation that the students need to show or we need to show? I think based on my experience, just be yourself. That is the first thing that you need to do. Like, I'm Sundanese, even though I'm not really Sundanese. I was born in Bandung, but my father is from Tanjung Morawa, so Medan is like in my heart. And then my mom is from Yogyakarta, but I was born in Bandung. So when I speak English, my Sundanese accent is very, very strong. I remember one of my lecturer, my professor in oh, ketahuan dong ya, jadi salah seorang profesor di UPI. Mungkin Bu Ana bisa nebak.
Bisa.
Ika, your English is very iteng English. You know, iteng adalah istrinya Kabayan. Kabayan adalah tokoh legendaris orang Sunda aja. Kalau kita cerita, selalu ada cerita si Kabayan. Dulu sih ada filmnya ya, si Didi Petet kalau zamannya saya. Kalau ya, Pak Mahmud ya, kan jauh lebih muda ya, jadi nggak zamannya Pak Didi Petet ya, movie-nya.
Muda.
Jadi ya ada si Kabayan, ada cerita Kabayan dan si Iteng. Iteng itu orang Sunda. So when I speak English, and at that time I think I was asked to be a master ceremony of a seminar, international seminar, and we did some rehearsal. During the rehearsal, langsung di komentarinya kayak gitu, your English is very Iteng English. Ya sedih sih ya gitu, tapi mau gimana lagi, orang saya memang orang Sunda gitu. I cannot sound British or Australian. Even though if I'm being forced, maybe I can imitate some of the accent, but I just want to retain my identity as a Sundanese. So this is the way I speak, and maybe at the end of my own intonation, sometimes my Sundanese accent is very, very strong, and that's fine. Because why I can say it's fine, because I've been through this competition, 3-minute competition itu, pertama levelnya level fakultas ya, Ibu Bapak di Wolonggo, fakultas, terus lawannya siapa? Ya mata biru, yang pirang, ya kan Pak Mahmud ya? Lawannya.
Mata sipit. Sama.
Kenapa?
Mata sipit.
Mata sipit juga ada gitu kan, yang mata sipit kayaknya kalau pronunciation-nya masih lebih jelas kita dari yang pada yang mata sipit. Aduh, jadi
tapi rasanya. Bisa menang loh, Miss.
Justru ya, bisa menang.
Yang full kan yang menguasai.
Betul sekali. Jadi meskipun lawannya mata biru rambut pirang, ternyata yang item-item kayak saya juga masih bisa menang juga gitu. Dan meskipun aksennya iteng, terus ada juga yang dari Korea, sometimes pronunciation is not really clear. Mungkin kalau sama dosen pronunciation kayaknya udah, kalau di UPI dulu sih kita salah pronunciation masih pakai mistar dipukul gitu, salah bunyinya misalnya begitu ya. Tapi ternyata juga bisa memenangkan kompetisi itu. Saya bisa masuk lolos ke tingkat universitas, tetap lawan-lawannya juga selain yang ada mata sipit sama yang mata biru. Terus masuk ke level yang Asia Pasifik, itu ya lebih banyak lagi yang mata biru rambut pirangnya gitu. Tapi saya bisa memenangkan itu juga. Artinya apa? Berarti yang punya aksen kayak Iteng juga nggak apa-apa. Aksennya kayak si Togar pun tak apalah itu. Gitu kan? Jadi... nggak masalah. Jadi yang penting adalah, tapi maksudnya juga bukan berarti kitanya ngaco ya. We try to articulate our presentation as clear as possible. And what is meant by clear? It is intelligible by many people from many backgrounds. Untungnya kalau orang Indonesia dari manapun kita berada, kita nggak punya kesulitan membunyikan huruf L dan R seperti orang Jepang misalnya. Jadi minimal misunderstanding can be minimized. But in terms of accents, it's a bit hard. Like kayak orang Jawa, teman saya orang Jawa pasti those are, pasti setelah ngomong those are, pasti masih ada N-nya di depan those are. Ya itu memang udah susah ya, nggak apa-apa. Tapi we still can understand that. Jadi kalau untuk speech competition, try to use the standard English as a reference. Of course, use that as a reference always. Try to be as close as possible. But when it is so hard to change, you don't have to be like, you don't have to sound like Harry Potter, or you don't have to sound like Katy Perry. It's fine. You can just be yourself in speech competition, yeah. Because I've been there, and I won the competition, so it's fine. Okay. Yeah. Pak Mahmud, mangga, silahkan.
Yeah. One more question, Ibu Ika.
Yes.
I think it's pretty simple. It says here, it's from Ibu Beta Sembiring. If we are a presenter in a seminar, is it also categorized as a public speaking?
Oh.
Ah. Quiz, Rika, quiz.
Quiz.
Yeah, quiz.
For me, public speaking is when you have to speak in front of people. That is public speaking. It can be formal, it can be informal. So... definitely, speaking in seminar is a public speaking. So it's public speaking is not only a politician doing a campaign. It's not only that. Even when we are teaching in front of our student, that is also public speaking. That's for me. That's what is meant by public speaking. But when we talk in a coffee shop, like me and Pak Mahmud, itu bukan public speaking. Kalau bahasa itu curhat,
sesi curhat. Gossip, curhat.
Itu gossip.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you okay. are with your friends, and then that's being informal, and you can do whatever you want. Tapi kalau public speaking, there are some of the rules that you need to follow. Meskipun rulesnya mungkin nggak explicitly mentioned, but even in the classroom, we are limited by time. 2 SKS mungkin sekitar 100 menit, and you have to make sure that your students engage, so you always have purpose. Ya, yeah? Seperti itu.
Okay, thank you, Ibu Ika. So it can also include a seminar, a lecture, as long as it is in front of a public, right?
Yes.
Yes, not gossiping and then crying together, right?
Uh-huh.
Yes, yes. Okay, thank you. I think we need to move on to the next slide, or you need to have a little break, perhaps?
It's up to you. Maybe we can just... go on ya, karena ini
we just go on. Okay,
ya,
all right,
okay. Jumatan ya soalnya,
yeah, right. Jumatan.
So this one I have another video, tapi memang narsistik banget karena video yang saya tunjukin videonya tentang saya semua ya. Supaya nggak copyright juga kan, aduh alasan. So in this video, I want you to identify what is the topic, and then who do you think the audience will be, and what kind of mode and what kind of modalities that you can play around when you do this kind of public speaking. Ini public speakingnya itu saya sendiri aja ya, yang bahwa public speaking itu ketika you have to speak in front of public. Mungkin ada definisi-definisi yang lain, but this is what I share with you now is that as long as you have to speak in front of public, then I will consider it as public speaking. So this video is produced by University of Wollongong. So I was asked by the International Office to do this filming, doing the, I don't know, is it kind of talk like that. So it's around 3 minutes, not that long. So while you're watching that, I want you to think about the topic and the audience and what kind of modalities that I have. Oh, can you see it or not? Yep. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we do.
Hello, my name is Ika. I love the outdoors, camping, and food. When I first arrived in Australia, the thing that was hugely different was the food. There's nothing better than making and eating the foods you love. So, from wherever you come from, here are my tips for buying your favorite food in Wollongong. Here, most people go to large supermarkets to buy their food. The main supermarket chains are Coles, Woolworths, and IGA. And the good thing is, it is on campus. All these supermarkets have a low variety of brands, but they have many cheaper options. There are also plenty of international grocery stores throughout Wollongong that specialize in products from Asia, Europe, Persia, and halal products. Dongfeng, it is one of my favorite Asian grocers because you can suggest a product that you would like them to stock on their shelves. If you move into a private rental accommodation, you will need to buy lots of things apart from your food. And maybe you need some clothes or other items that did not quite fit into your suitcase. Definitely go to the UOW Goodwill Hunting event at the beginning of the session for heaps of free stuff. I got my things for my kitchen, my bedroom, and other furniture. There are also online pages, such as the UOW Student Buy and Sell Facebook page, or Gumtree for secondhand items that people are selling or giving away for free. And you know what? I bought a kayak. Secondhand clothing, toys, books, furniture, and other things are sold in stores called op shops. There are lots of op shops such as Salvos, Beanies, and Red Cross. Australians often put things out beside the road, and this means it's going to be thrown away, and they are free to take. Yeah, and you can find some good things there too. If you like to buy things here, and the more budget shop for household items and clothes are Kmart, BW, Best & Last, and Target. It's a good idea to bring your own bags, because at some shops, you need to pay for plastic bags. Make sure you jump online to check out what shops are close to where you will be staying and the opening hours, as these may be different to what you are used to. And thankfully, the amazing free bus services has bus stops near most of these places, so it is super easy to access them. I hope this is helpful, and don't be scared to ask people when you arrive where the best parking is.
Okay. Jadi itu ya kenangan ke Wollongong ya Pak Mahmud. Okay, Ibu Bapak. So as I mentioned earlier, while you watch that, I would like you to think about the topic and what kind of audience that you think it is for and what kind of modalities. You may respond to one of those points by typing in the chat. Karena kalau saya tanya biasanya pada diem-diem. Kita lihat dulu di chat yuk. Silakan Ibu Bapak tolong tulis. Who do you think the audience is for that video? The intended audience, and then what kind of modalities, what kind of features or mode or the tools that I have to do this public speaking, and then what is the topic? Thank you, Ibu Winda. So the audience will be for new students arriving at Wollongong. Yeah, yeah. The topic is, kata Bu Anna, shopping foods. Yes. Perhaps the potential audience, iya. Silakan yang lain ditunggu juga chatnya. Please type more. You can just
write on one of the points, either the topics or the modalities, or perhaps the audience. Ini udah ada sih topik sama audiensnya ya. Kira-kira mungkin ada yang mau jump in to talk about the modalities. Rada bingung ya modalitasnya apa ya? Ada stage nggak? Nggak ada stage di situ ya. Jadi adanya apa aja sih? Kira-kira? Ini nggak ada lagi yang masuk di chat? Alright. Atau mau langsung bicara, kira-kira ada yang mau share? Bu Isli, lupa modalities. Aduh, jangan pakai istilahnya, jangan modalities ya. Jangan modalities. Itu kira-kira pakai ada apa aja sih yang membantu pesan tersampaikan lewat video itu? Kalau pakai video pastinya ada apa ya? Pasti ada kamera. Terus ada apa lagi ya? Musik? Itu aja sih. Ada microphone, yes. Terus ada apa lagi? Ada snapshot. Jadi saya pas ngomong ada video-video berjalan juga. Ini Bu Isli ngasih message, private message. Tapi nggak boleh dibaca kayaknya.
Okay. Udah dibilang.
Ada running text, yes, Artiliana, Ibu Artiliana, thank you, yes. Iya, baik. Jadi memang kalau kita lihat ya, perbedaannya dengan yang di TED Talk itu kan live ya. Ketika live, nggak ada dong back sound seperti itu. Kalau tadi karena itu di video, sekarang kan yang namanya public speakingnya juga bisa online, bisa recorded seperti itu. Nah, musik mungkin membantu dan ada tayangan-tayangan yang juga bergerak sambil ketika saya menjelaskan. So, these are the things that are appropriate for digital storytelling, let's say. But you need to be careful when you are asked to do a presentation Zoom like this, because it just happened last night. So I was asked to be one of the judges for mahasiswa berprestasi di UPI. One of them present their PowerPoint presentation using back sound. Jadi mirip seperti, karena mungkin anak sekarang ya, anak-anak yang digital native itu, semua fitur yang ada, karena jagoan, bukan berarti saya lagi iri ya, enggak lagi iri. Karena presentasinya jadi menarik. Ada back soundnya. Jadi ketika clicking PowerPoint itu sambil ada musik seperti yang tadi ketika video yang saya tunjukkan in YouTube. So because why it's not appropriate in that kind of presentation buat mahasiswa berprestasi, even though kelihatannya jadi memang menarik, tapi for some audience it will be very distracting because they will focus on the sounds, focus on the animation. So at the end of the presentation, I did not get what he said because I was amazed by those fancy technological things around his presentation. Beda dengan yang YouTube yang tadi saya tunjukkan, memang ada unsur entertainment-nya. Entertaining, and then it is for the students yang, and mungkin potential students coming to Wollongong. Ya, jadi memang harus menarik membuat anak-anak muda yang zaman sekarang pengen ikut gitu ya. And constantly throughout the video, I was asked to smile a lot, even though I tried. It was hard to smile from the beginning to the end. Then, and you also need to consider when you do your presentation, even though you need to be friendly. Tadi kan di waktu survei ada yang menyebutkan a good public speaker itu yang friendly, smile. But be careful. It depends on the topics that you are talking about. So when you talk about a patient with cancer, you cannot smile during your presentation. So even though you need to smile and being friendly, but you also need to be aware of the topic that you talk about. If you talk about history where there is very sad and devastating event happening, try not to smile. Yeah? So you even though Indonesian, we tend to smile for any situation
we are grieving, we are feeling sorry about something, we smile, we tend to smile, but it can cause misunderstanding. So that's why talking about modalities is important, talking about the platform that you are going to present is important, because you will think about the choices that you need to make. Yeah. So don't get confused even though you are doing presentation online. Seperti yang terjadi pada mahasiswa yang tadi malam yang saya lihat, ketika presentasi mempresentasikan risetnya, researchnya, but using background things like the video that I showed you earlier, so it won't be appropriate because it is very distracting. Yeah. Okay. Actually, I have I also have this stage. I would like you to experiment how to do your beginning and end your presentation using Flipgrid, but I don't think we can have time for that. I just would like to show you that when you start your presentation, because being confident is important, unless you want to make a point about being confident. So it's very important for you to select what kind of expressions that you are going to say in the beginning of your presentation. Pak Mahmud, can you invite, ini ada mahasiswa kan ya?
Nah, sepertinya ada ini.
Sepertinya ada bisa. Ya? Yeah. Kalau ada mahasiswa mungkin bisa di-invite untuk membacakan ekspresi ini.
Anyone would like to volunteer? Saya juga sih sebenarnya mahasiswa juga, Bu Ika.
Oh iya ya.
Iya.
Boleh. Mau saja.
Iya. Bu Ana juga barangkali mahasiswa senior.
Oke. How many then Bu Ana?
Okay. So, good morning. Thank you for having me on this beautiful day. I'm very delighted to be sharing with you all about public speaking.
Yes, thank you. Bu Anna, it's your turn now for the pink one.
Oh, okay. Today, let me start by apologizing for presenting about public speaking. Actually, my lecturer, who is the expert, is here in this room. But I will try to do my best here.
Alright, thank you Pak Mahmud and Bu Anna. Nah, Ibu Bapak, what do you think? Which one do you like better, the yellow one or the pink one to start your presentation? Ibu Amana, perhaps you would like to say something? You can turn on your microphone.
Thank you for the opportunity. I think it is better to start the public speaking by the one in the yellow one.
Yeah, why is that, Bu?
Because sometimes, even though we know that we have weaknesses in presenting our opinion or ideas, or sometimes we make mistakes at the line during the public speaking, I think it is not
creative.
It should not that we have to say sorry at the beginning of the public speaking. I think when we say apologizing at the beginning or before we give the line during the public speaking, it ourselves or the speaker down first at the first time. Yeah. So it reduces the confidence of the speaker himself or herself.
Yes, that's right, Bu Amana. Thank you, Bu Amana. Yeah. So yellow one is the better one to start our public speaking. We do not need to apologize again because you are given the floor because of your expertise. And in the international events, they won't
they won't expect you to apologize because they already trust you to give the presentation. But sometimes in our culture as Indonesian, even though we do not do any mistake, we will feel sorry, maaf, saya akan mengajukan pertanyaan atau izin saya boleh bertanya, things like that. It depends again where you are, but I think you do not need to apologize, yeah? You don't need to say sorry, because I think I have made mistake. If you made mistake, then don't present. Don't present something with lots of mistakes, because we don't want to listen to your, what is it, broken project, yeah? Unless it is about monitoring or evaluating. But even so, it's not a mistake, yeah? So you need to be confident by saying straight to the, by introducing the topic that you are going to talk about. And Monica, Ibu Monica from in the chat saying that she preferred the yellow one, but I usually do the pink one because of the power of audience that I said above. Yeah, because Ibu Monica mentioned that earlier, what if there is someone who is more expert? And I can feel you, Ibu, because when I did my examination untuk proposal, seminar proposal misalnya, atau juga when I did my 3-minute thesis competition, or even here in this presentation, because I know Pak Mahmud is there, but Pak Mahmud is my friend, but I thought that he is powerful as well. So sometimes I also feel that, oh, ini udah bener gak ya? Aduh, takut ada yang salah nih gitu ya. But still you do not need to apologize because we have prepared, unless you are not preparing anything. But once you are given a time and chance to present, make sure that you make the preparation. Apalagi untuk international event. Dan kalau menurut saya, even for any kind of event, if you are given the honor to present something, mau dibayar atau nggak dibayar, do your best. Because it will come with your image. So, do not apologize because you have prepared. Tidak masalah mau ada lecturer, mau ada siapa yang memang lebih expert, but this is what you're going to present is the best of you. Yeah? Okay, now let's move on to the ending, how to end the ini. Nah, the closing. So, we need to try to make the audience remember the key message. Ibu Monica, are you there? Yes, Bu Monica, ada nggak? Yes, tapi bisa buka speakernya nggak Bu Monica? I would like to hear your voice. Perhaps you can read the yellow one for us.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, thank you. Yes.
To wrap up, let's remind ourselves of why Flipgrid should matter to everyone here.
And then the pink one, perhaps just do both.
Oh, the time is up. I still have one more point to talk about, but it's okay. I will give you my PowerPoint. Thank you.
Yeah. Any comment on this kind of closing, Ibu Bapa? Oh, the time is up. I still have one more point to talk about, but it's okay. I will give you my PowerPoint. Thank you. Pernah ngalamin kayak gini? Pak Mahmud pernah? Pak Mahmud lagi.
Oh, of course. Of yeah. Course lah, Bu Eka.
Of course, ya. Yeah, yeah. Saya juga dulu sering banget ngalamin seperti itu ketika belum belajar bahwa sebaiknya ada batasan waktu. Itu paling menyebalkan kalau di conference. In the conference, belum nyampe ke ending itu terus panitia udah 2 menit lagi, 1 menit lagi. Gitu udah sampai akhirnya udah terganggu, distracted by being reminded about the time. Sampai finally habis waktunya. So actually, one can be avoided if you prepare your presentation. So as I mentioned earlier, if you are given time, remember, one slide can be delivered in 1 to 3 minutes. So if you have 15 minutes, just think how many slides should you have? Nah, saya nggak bisa ngitung matematika. Kalau 15 menit berarti berapa? Berapa slides nih? kalau satu slide-nya 3 menit Ibu Bapak?
5,
thank you ya. 5 slides. Mana? Bukan sampai 50 slides karena penting semua dipindahin dari apa research project report-nya. So, think about the time and then you prepare that, ya. Well, so as I mentioned earlier, to end your presentation, you can start to make the conclusion and make a powerful quote, yeah, if you like. For me, I would like to wrap up my presentation by saying, let's practice, let's share our experience and worries with your colleagues, because with collaboration, we can be a better person. Thank you very much. If you have any questions and more comments, I will give it to Pak Mahmud, and perhaps we still have 10 minutes to discuss that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ibu Ika. Yeah. So what I can learn today about doing a successful public speaking, I think there are 3 things: prepare, practice, and be confident. That's what I can learn, I can get so far. So if you have other questions related to the topic today, you know, how to be more confident perhaps, if you want to know more stuff about being more confident when doing public speaking, or perhaps something, how to relate the skills, public speaking skills, to your teaching. Ibu Ika is the expert here. Any questions, please?
Oh yeah, Ibu Ika, maybe.
Yes.
I will ask a question. Do you believe gesture is important in public speaking?
Gesture?
Yes.
Gesture. Yes, of course, gesture is very important. Yes, thank you for bringing this out, Pak. I'm a kind of person who is fidgety a lot, you know. I tend to move, and I'm not realizing that actually I move my body. So yes, you need to control your gesture as well. Make sure that it's not distracting your audience. Why I'm saying this? Because once I get reminded by my colleague, you keep on moving back and forth from side to side. I just got confused what you're talking about, because I keep on looking at you moving from left to right, back and forth like that. So it's like setrikaan while you are talking. So I think it depends on your personality and your audience. But I think if you move a lot, I think everything, yang segala sesuatu yang berlebihan, it's not good. I know that I cannot stop fidgeting, but I have to control myself. So, especially in a limited time presentation, I will also think about the gesture that I'm going to use. And I will force myself to stand in certain points. But because of my personality, I need to move to get my brain going to think. So I will move, but I will be aware when I'm moving. So I'm trying not to overdoing it. And yes, gesture is very important, Pak Muhammad Nasir. And another important thing is making eye contact with your audience. I know that in the olden days, I was told that if you are nervous, because as I told you earlier, actually I'm not that confident speaker, some of them told me not to look at the audience eyes, but going beyond their eyes, like to their head, something like that. But I think it's not helping much, because I got distracted with their hairstyle, for example. And then I will be overthinking about the hair that they have. And I think looking at their eyes straight away, it's helping me much, because I know that they are with me. Dan ketahuan juga ketika ada yang mulai ngantuk, and I get annoyed, and I want to make sure that person is with me. I will try to draw their attention. Yeah, and there are some tricks as well how to get attention from
your sleepy audience. Mungkin ini di kesempatan yang lain lagi ya, we can do that as well. Yes, Muhammad Nasir.
There is one other question here in the chatting room, Ibu Ika.
Yes.
I think it's about how to open your public speaking. It says here, the pink one is the influence of our culture. Even the speaker is confident, but the culture influenced her or him. So it's better to apologize first.
Yeah. Yes. So that's why in one of the principles that I mentioned, you need to think about the audience. Yeah, the audience. And then the modalities, again, where you are. But the audience is one of... Because the three variables are equally important. So think where you are presenting. Who are your audience? So if you are presenting within your prodi, for example, it is quite a close community and you know one another and you also know the culture that you all, you have to mention, you have to address your superior by calling their title, professor or doctor something. So you do that because you are in that community, in the very closed community. But if you go further in a wider community, for example, in the national level, not all people can, I mean, it's okay not to apologize, even though it is Indonesian culture in general. But I think nationally, people will more understand now because nationally, people have more experience. And if you go even higher into the international level, skip those kind of things. Because when you apologize, it will turn off their respect for you because they think that, oh, you are not competent. So why are you on the stage? And this is what I learned as Indonesian is that, and I believe Pak Mahmud also knows because we often talk about this, we are not... Confident is not because we are not capable, but sometimes we don't want to be considered as sombong, as ria. Wah, ini ria nih lagi nyombong-nyombongin diri ya. Padahal in an academic presentation, I think that is the place for you to be ria, tanda petik. Because people want to know your expertise. You have to show your expertise because people can learn from your expertise. Bukan bermaksud mau menyombongkan keahlian saya ini itu. Tapi itu mah kembali lagi ya, malaikat yang bisa mencatat niat kita mau apa. So when you show your expertise, your strength, because you want to share that with people, to the people that you know, or to the audience. So I think that's fine. Ya, karena sekarang kalau misalnya, ini dikit-dikit kok disombongin gitu ya. So I think you have to consider the audience that you have. Yeah.
Yes, there is a hands up here.
Ibu Nani.
Ibu Nani. Oh, Ibu Nani. Come on, please. Anything you would like to ask Ibu Nani to Ibu Ika?
You can turn on your microphone, Bu Nani, atau kepencet itu.
Mungkin kepencet.
Oh, Pak Mahmud, I have a question.
Yes.
Pak Mahmud.
Iya. Yeah.
Iya, yeah, this is Winda speaking. Yeah.
Umi Winda. Yeah,
yeah. I have one question to Bu Ika. It happens to me, few times. How can we deliver to such a powerful or effective conclusion in our public speaking? I mean, and not in terms of the content of the speech, but in terms of our verbal presentations. Of course, I mean, eventually, at the end of the day, we would like to, grab the audience attention by giving, effective and powerful conclusion. Can you share your experience? Thank you, Ika.
Yes, Ibu Winda. Oh, I really like your voice. I think you are a good singer.
Yes. Forward.
Yes. To end your presentation, again, it depends on your... presentation event or occasion. And also the purpose of the presentation itself. Perhaps I can also, maybe in other occasion if we have time, another time, we can talk about focusing on certain events and how we can adjust or modify how to end our presentation. But to conclude, I think you can show the slide. Yeah, you can show the slide where you post your powerful quote, or you can show significant result of your findings, but not very long and wordy. You can put it in one sentence, let's say, or some keywords that you want to show. You can also show picture that can wrap up the result of your research. And then perhaps like what I did yesterday, for example, in a webinar with teachers in West Java, when I try to persuade them to use dongeng when they teach their class, and it's not only for English teacher, not, this is for all subject matters. So at the end, I will just say, because towards the end of a presentation, I did a storytelling with them, and then at the end, I will just say, showing up a slide and then tell them, "Yuk, kita ngedongeng." And that's all. So that's how I end my presentation, because that's actually the point that I want my audience take when they go back to their school, because that's the message that I want them to remember and to do at school, because I want them to do storytelling with their students. Yeah. So at the end, you can just put the key message that you want your audience take away after your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Ibu Ika. I think it's time. It's 11, okay, 11:01 right now. It is time. Thank you so much. We have learned a lot from you today. Again, public speaking, it's all about prepare, practice, be confident, and be yourself, right, Ibu Ika?
Yes.
Yes, be yourself. Okay. So I'll just return the, what do you call this? The Friday Forum to our chair, Pak Muhammad Natsir.
Yeah, thank you, Pak Mahmud. Yeah, thank you, Ibu Ika, for sharing all the experience for us. So we will grasp your knowledge very, very attentional. For me, it's really precious thing. Yeah, I think for all the audiences, this is the precious, very precious thing that we can share with Ibu Ika Damayanti. Yeah, thank you for spending the time for us, giving us, sharing us. The knowledge is very, very useful for us as a teacher, as a practitioner, as a lecturer, all profession. Already got the knowledge from Ibu Ika Lestari Damayanti. For all the audience, thank you for sharing again your time for us in this Friday forum today. And for all the team, thank you for creating this magnificent moment for me, yeah? Maybe for us, yeah, because this is the topic is today is, I think this is not only for the language, not only for linguistic, this is for all profession. So we got the knowledge really. I mean the knowledge is not specific for us. I mean yeah, for our department. I think this is for all department, for sociology, for mathematics, for whatever. They are profession in here.
That's right.
So the knowledge is for me. Yeah, for me is really precious. I think all the audience also get this knowledge to their preparation for teaching, their preparation for all their jobs, to differentiate, to distinguish, yeah, between which one is public speaking? Which one is curhat, ya Bu ya? Tadi ya kan? Nah, for me is, yeah,
it's really clear which one is too hard, which one is public speaking, so we can distinguish between them. So when we are going to give a public speaking, like you told us just now, that's the way. When you are going to cafe or whatever, you are curhat, that's the way. So the topic is not related, all right? Yeah, thank you very much again. Okay, on behalf of Friday Forum, I would say thank you very much, Ibu Lestari Damayanti. You mentioned, I don't want to mention again, because this is Jumatan. It's already time and all. For Pak Mahmud, yeah, thank you for your time. Ibu Anna Tambunan, I'm sorry, Ibu. thank you. I did not mention you before because I thought if Pak Mahmud is closing friendship. Ika, so I mentioned Bu Hana, something wrong. And Pak Indra, Ibu Ketua Jurusan, Ibu Head Department, Ibu KCC, maybe another project, I don't know. But for today, Friday Forum, we really get something that is different thing. I mean, this is for all scope. For all departments can grasp this knowledge, how to speak, how to head up your speak, head up and speak up. This is not theoretically is easy, but practically is not really easy. Like you told us, Ibuika. Yes. Hard job. Maybe you got a lot of experience, but for us, we having got a chance to having those experience like you have. Okay, thank you again all for the audience, Ibu Ika, Pak Mahmud, Pak Indra Hartoyo, Bu Anna. I could mention one by one your name. Mm-hmm. All the audience that spent their time in here. Thank you again, Pak Toms. Okay, thank you, Pak Toms. And Pak Toms, I think, is regularly every Friday follow this.
Yeah, a regular participant.
Yeah, regular participant, yeah. Thank you, and I'm hoping we will see you on next Friday forum. Thank you, Ibu Ika.
Thank you,
Bandung,
Pak. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Ibu Ika.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Yeah, so we are very thankful
for coming.
So
thank
you.
Thank you, Pak. Ibu Ika, terima kasih.
Thank you for the sharing.
Okay, bye-bye.
So everyone, okay, bye-bye everyone. So let's meet again.
Bye.
Okay, let's meet again.
Bye-bye, Bang In.
Bye.
Okay, bye, Memana.
Okay.
Suara. Ya, Pak. Oke.
Hari ini acara karena dia mencakup semua.
Ibu Ika.
Iya.
Terima kasih, Pak In.
Ya, terima kasih, Bu Mesuri. Bu Mei ini dari awal tadi dia sudah bergabung.
Cuma lagi mobile juga sih. Oke.
Okay. Walaupun sambil kesana kemari, tapi tetap mendengarkan, Ibu ya. Menyimak. Prof. Mungkin Berlin juga. Ini Berlin yang sangat sibuk pun masih.
Saya mendengar tadi Pak Indra.
Iya, Pak Berlin.
Saya mendengar jangan pandang mata orang ketika kita berpidato.
Jadi saya tak boleh memandang Bapak sekarang ini. Makanya aja suara saja.
Iya,
Pak Berlin.
Oke. Okay. Jangan memandang audiensnya katanya. Walaupun Ibu Ika lebih suka memandang.
Ada-ada aja Pak Berlin ini.
Kan tadi kan dibilang gak boleh lihat mata. Enggak. Yang ini.
Maksudnya katanya, jangan salah grogi. Pandang Pak Berlin. Iya. Jangan.
Jadi saya tutuplah, saya bikinlah gambar saya daripada saya dipandang. Rupanya tambah grogi orang karena gambarnya lebih.
Oke, oke, oke. Iyalah. Iya, Prof. Betul. Oke, oke. Okay. Baik, terima kasih Prof. Ya, terima kasih.
Saya ingin
Iya, sama-sama terima kasih semua yang sudah hadir. Kita jumpa lagi di Friday Forum berikutnya. Pak Nasir, nanti kita bicarakan untuk yang bulan 8 itu ya, yang ya, international, okay. Karena itu harus jadi ini apa prioritas kita ya.
Iya, siap Pak.
Ya. Oke, sip ya. Kita tutup room ini ya. Oke, terima kasih Bapak Ibu.
Yuk semuanya. Terima kasih. Ya,
sama-sama Pak. Terima kasih Pak Indra.
Ya, sama-sama Pak Surya.